Welcome to the Ugly Bug Podcast, a production of the Ugly Bug Fly Shop and Crazy Rainbow Fly Fishing.
Hey everyone, thank you for joining us on the Ugly Bug Podcast. Today I had the opportunity to sit down with Fish, one of the guides here at the Ugly Bug Fly Shop and Crazy Rainbow, and we were able to discuss some Stillwater tactics, which is a passion of Fish's and something that he's very talented at. And kind of our local guru. So I think you'll enjoy the conversation, hopefully learn a thing or two. But before we jump into the podcast, let's take a listener question real quick. This question comes from Tony in Thornton, Colorado. Tony's asking, or Tony states, Blake, I'm interested in fly tying. I'm interested in a fly tying setup, and I've been looking at some setups. I'm struggling with the cost. Is fly tying really a good way to save money? The answer to that is yes and no. So yes, it's a good way to save some money if you're really tying a lot of flies. And it's a valuable thing to do if you're trying to manipulate some flies. You're interested in coming up with your own flies. But often if you're not an real avid angler and going through a large number of flies, the advantages to tying really aren't in the cost savings. So once you add up the gear and the equipment you kind of need and then start buying materials, often, you know, if you buy a batch of materials to tie a specific fly and you only tie six of them, you're really not going to save much money when it's all said and done. If you're tying a large quantity of them, then yeah, it makes a lot more sense. But to me, the value in tying flies is obviously the overall enjoyment, right? It's kind of an adult crafting project sort of thing. Personally, for me, it's a kind of a great meditation sort of thing. Slows me down, makes me focus on something. But it allows for some creativity and it really allows the tire to customize a fly specific to what they're seeing on the water. So in some situations, a standard pheasant tail might be a little too robust through the thorax or something like that. You'd like to make it thinner. Obviously, tying your own bug allows for that to happen. So not really the shortest of answers and not really bringing a ton of clarity there as far as yes or no, but hopefully you kind of understand where I'm coming at it there. So yes, it totally makes sense if you're tying a bunch of flies, but if you're only looking to tie a few, you're probably better off to still purchase them. So thank you very much for the question, and let's jump in to our podcast today with Fish.
The Ugly Bug Podcast is proudly sponsored by Flyoming. Wyoming rooted fly fishing apparel and accessories challenging the traditional mold, designed by anglers for anglers.
How you doing, Fish?
I'm doing good.
Good, man. Figured we'd have a little discussion about Stillwater. You're kind of the local Stillwater guru around here.
Yeah, for sure.
Looking for a little insight. Maybe you can help out some listeners, for the few tips and tactics and kind of how you approach a Stillwater. So for those that don't know, you know, we've got kind of multiple ponds, lakes, reservoirs around central Wyoming. And obviously you have some expertise outside of that in Colorado. So around here, I'm sure, you know, you don't have to give out all the trade secrets sort of stuff, but we've got some fun bodies of water that you can kind of easily access around Casper if you're looking to get out on a lake.
Yeah, for sure. So when I moved here, from Colorado, and it was kind of funny, the guy that was unpacking the glass table at my house saw the drift boat in the garage and the fly rods, and he goes, "Oh, you're a fisherman." And I go, "Yeah." And he said, "I kind of like fishing lakes." And he goes, "Do you know about golden eye?" And I said, "No, tell me." And he goes, "Five fish, 25 pounds." So I moved into Casper on the July 1st. And so the morning of July 4th, I was on Goldeneye fishing. And went out there, again, sight unseen. It rained the night before, which Goldeneye does cloud up a little bit. But caught five fish that were probably close to 25 pounds. It was kind of a cool thing.
And, yeah.
The biggest thing about here is there's just nobody doing the Stillwater thing. I grew up in, you know, like I said, in Colorado, and on a given day at Spinney Mountain Reservoir, you'll have 50 to 100 float tubers and drift boats and fly fishermen out on the lake. And I fish Goldeneye a lot the first year, and I bet you maybe two times I saw other people out there. Other than that, I had the lake to myself, and I've caught my personal best cutthroat out there and my personal best brook trout out of the Goldeneye. So it's one of those places that easy to get to, but it's a cool fishery. And then I've just kind of morphed into, I've been trying different things. I've been, I like to fish Pathfinder when the ice comes off, which is kind of depends, normally the first or second week of March, and if you, or of April, and if you can find the right non-windy day, it mm-hmm. can be very, very good. And fish a lot of, and I'm fishing from the bank, fishing probably 20 feet out, fishing normally leeches or scuds or hairsers or something like that. So it's one of those things that people don't think about, but there's a lot of fish that cruise the banks in that time of year. So.
Yeah. When you were in Colorado, were you primarily fishing them from the bank, or were you using a boat, or how did you
know, in the spring, when the ice comes off, you normally fish it from the bank is the way Spinney works, or Delaney Buttes is the other one I used to fish quite a bit. You'd fish from the bank. Actually bought a drift boat back in 99 for the strict reason of getting out in the lake. So once the I'd say mid-March, you start getting what is called a corona mid-hatch, which is a large mm-hmm. mid-hatch, kind of looks like a big mosquito without the biting part. In here too, but in Colorado, they'll swarm to the fact that, like, they call them buzzers because when you walk through the grass, they're actually buzzing as you're walking to the lake. So it's a big red rockworm, basically, is what you fish, but very effective. And then after that, you get into a Calabatus, which is pretty much the only lake mayfly, which is a gray, fairly good size normally, 14, 16, maybe a 12 gray mayfly. Hare's ear is a great example for duplicating that, so you fish a hare's ear. And so what I normally do is I'll get out on a lake. If I don't know the body of water, I always look for points normally. Like you see a point, normally there's a shelf, or that's kind of where I'd start, is trying to find like a edge there, because these fish will, they basically just cruise around looking for stuff to eat. So you'll be out there on the lake and you'll be dead for 15 minutes. Then all of a sudden you're on fire for 15 minutes as this school comes through. And then it's kind of those things that you just know what to expect. And what I normally do is I fish, I started doing this here, but I'll take a forceps and put it on my bottom fly and go all the way down and find out where the exact bottom is, and then raise my indicator about a foot off the bottom, and that's kind of my starting point. So don't leave the forceps on there because they don't bite as good with the forceps on there, but it's a good way to find your depth.
Sounds like you maybe done that experience.
Well, I've lost twice. About four or five forceps because they weren't on good enough. When I kind of threw it out there, they came off, but started experimenting in Colorado and did it here too on Goldeneye, and fishing in that 15 to 18 foot depth, which takes a little bit different gear. I use an indicator that actually is like a slip indicator, that when you set the hook, it actually breaks free of the knot. And so the indicator rides along the leader. So that's kind of a cool strategy, and yeah. I've done that out at Goldeneye, and actually worked fishing about 17 feet of water. And you get out there, and there'll be a guy or two out there, and they're just like, well, "What are you doing?" You know, like they don't understand. So it's those fish are normally deep. So if you're out in the water, fish towards the bottom.
So that indicator system, kind of explain, how is that thing rigged up? Is there a knot at the bottom end, or is it a twist in the?
So
the bubble itself,
on the bottom of it, there's a piece of monofilament, and so if you put the leader through that and it rides up and down the monofilament, then on the bottom of the indicator there's a short piece of tubing. So what you do is you take the tube and you pull the tubing off, you put a little loop in there, and then you slide the tubing back up there and catch that leader like that. So then when you set the hook, that loop just pulls through and you're back on that monofilament riding up and down. So when you pull it out, like if anybody's around you, they figure you're fishing 2 feet deep because you run all the way down to the top fly with your indicator, but makes it land, and it's hard to land a fish at 14, 15 feet.
Yeah.
It's impossible to land a fish. So
I used to not knowing any better, my solution was a little water balloon, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'd tie on the water balloon thing, and then in order to land the fish, you know, we'd get it sucked into the tip of the rod, move your hand down, pop the balloon, and then you could get it inside the guides.
Right.
I remember one time I thought I was going to outsmart the system, right? And I brought a little BB gun, and I thought, I'll just shoot the balloon as it's out there. And, of course, it wasn't a good enough shot. And I actually shot the rod tip off one of my buddy's rods once, trying to pop the water balloon that was at the end of it. But so those bubbles, are you using like a teardrop sort of bubble, or is it just a ball? Or
it kind of looks like the old the one I use kind of looks like the old bait bobbers. It's got a post on the bottom, then the indicator looks like a regular indicator, then it's got a post on the top, which has got normally some bright colors.
Yeah.
And so what's nice about it is when you throw it out and it goes down, when it hits the bottom, the indicator tips up like that. So, you know, you're straight up and down. And then, yeah, like I said, when you set the hook, it rides up and down. So it's an interesting thing. I met this guy, I was up at Delaney Butte's story, and they were out in the middle and they were hammering fish, and we were in 10 feet of water and we were not catching fish. So as you do when you're fly fishing, you don't know what's going on, you ask questions. Mm-hmm. So he came off and I said, my favorite thing on the river is I got to ask. When somebody looks at you and goes, I got to ask, it's like, okay, because they know you're killing it and they don't know what they're doing. So I got to ask. And he goes, you got one of these indicators? I said, no. Nah. He goes, got to go to Walden, the fly shop. I sell, you know, this guy was the inventor of this indicator.
Oh, cool.
And sold him to the fly shop. So he wouldn't give me any for free. He made me go to the fly shop, which was 10 miles away. So me and my buddy ran into town, got a couple indicators, went back out. Like, it's middle of the day, which is not the best time to fish, you know, 2-3 o'clock, got out in 20 feet of water and did this. And if we didn't catch a bunch of fish, and I'm like, I'll be. And so kind of, you know, you learn. And so, yeah, this guy, I don't know if he, you know, obviously I don't know if he's still alive, but he basically lives up there for like the month of May on the river, on the lake. He just lives for that. And I watched him catch big, big fish doing that. So
yeah,
it's definitely a.
So often, like in a river scenario, we're actually reading the tilt or the lean a little bit of the bubble, right? Mm-hmm. It's one reason a lot of strike indicators are two-tone or whatever, so you can kind of see the movement. In most strikes on a lake, is it just going down, or do you see it like tilt or lean? Do you, I guess in theory, do you see a subtle strike on Stillwater, or is it always just it hammers it?
You do. Normally in the chronomid hatch, for whatever reason, I always call it ringing the bell, because you'll see the indicator twitch like this a little bit, and then it will shoot down. But it's kind of like a warning, like, okay, here it comes, and then it's kind of one of those things. In like the calabatus, or if you're using leeches or scuds or something like that, a little bit more of a just gone, like now you see it, now you don't kind of thing. But, you know, my big thing with the Stillwater is you just, there's a lot of big fish in Stillwater. You catch a lot of big fish. And, like I said, here, there's no pressure.
Yeah.
There's a lake here, which, is an old, I believe a uranium mine, called Walker Jenkins. And, it doesn't hold big fish, but it offers you a chance to spot fish with dry flies or with nymphs. And it's just a cool place because it's so gin clear that you can see these fish coming and you can throw a hopper out in front of them and stuff like that. It's just, again, it's something that people don't do. You know, I've never seen anybody else fishing that other than with a spin rod, but go out there and throw hoppers at fish that are cruising and watching them come up is kind of a cool thing.
So, yeah, a lot of fun.
There's a lot of opportunities that, and a lot of lakes around here that just, if you spend a little time and worked them, you can find some fish.
So are you, you mentioned you're looking for points, obviously somewhat like you would in a river system, like some structure, a drop off, a shelf. Are you also looking for other debris, like if you see a big log hanging out, or do you kind of try to focus on those big rock points?
You know, I just kind of, I started with the points and then just, again, try to find, I play with the depths. Like, I always feel 10 feet is a good depth. So I try to, you know, I don't look for logs. Again, there's not a lot of rivers or lakes out here. There's not a lot of that kind of stuff out here. Cool thing that I've done in the past is you can run a hopper dropper in a lake. You can fish 2 feet deep and throw a hopper up on the bank, and they'll, when they're cruising, they'll eat a, you know, scud or a hares or whatever. Under, it's a cool thing too. It's cool catching a big fish on a hopper in a lake. You know, you hear about it up in, I've not seen it here. Used to see it in Colorado a little bit, and I just haven't fished the hatches enough. But like up on Henry's Lake and, what's the other one up there?
Quake.
Hebgen Lake.
Yeah.
You get what they call gulpers, which is the mayfly hatch was the Calabatus. You'll watch these fish just eating flies as they pick them all the way down, and then you have to judge where they're going and try to stay in front of them. And it's a cool thing too. And then when you hook one, you know, 'cause they're not expecting it. It's just, it's a different deal. So, I love the lake thing. It's kind of cool. I'm actually looking to make a trip right now, chasing golden trout and also tiger trout. And those are, you're going to find in lakes most of the time. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at lakes right now, trying to find some place I can go up on a weekday and go up and do that. So if you learn how to fish a lake in town, then you can always go and chase other fish in other lakes. And, you know, and I also do, I've caught pike in lakes. I've caught carp in lakes. I've caught smallmouth in lakes. So, I mean, it's not just trout fishing too.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a cool deal.
I think your point about, you know, like Walker Jenkins having smaller fish, but they're just a riot. I think, you know, I've not done a lot of lake fishing, but some of what I've done is like panfish. And with a little 2-weight or a small little, like, I'll steal my daughter's fly rod sort of thing, they're a riot, right? And they're opportunistic, and they love to eat. They're like little brook trout. They just gobble it up if it's close to them. So
yeah,
it can be a lot of fun.
Tempted to get a fiberglass rod and go do some of that stuff too, and just go chase some little fish with a fiberglass rod and just have some fun. But it's one of those things that I think, at least in this area, I mean, the river system here is so good and people love coming here for the river, but there's a lot of other stuff here, especially if the weather isn't right or whatever. You can always save a trip by going and finding a lake or a pond. Or, I mean, I've seen big browns in the lake here in town. There's a little by the dog park. There's a lake, and I was out paddleboarding. I wasn't fishing, but I was out paddleboarding and ran across like a 20-inch brown out there. So there's some big fish even in just the local ponds around here. That if got an afternoon and want to kill it, go find a pond. So it's kind of a nice option.
Yeah, for sure. Do you, like around here, we're blessed. We talked a little bit about Golden Eye. There's a few other ponds. A lot of our stuff has like some high sulfur content, which usually leads to really good scud growth. When you're fishing scuds, do you find yourself running, you briefly mentioned like 18 inches, roughly 18 inches off the bottom, a couple feet off the bottom. When you're throwing scuds, do you still hang out in that 2-foot zone or a little closer?
Scuds, and normally I rig it. I've not rigged 3 flies. I've always rigged just 2 flies. I normally run the bottom fly is 1 foot off the bottom. I'll put it 18 inches between the flies, and I'll put the weight in between the flies so it gets them both down. You know, one of my – it's funny. I never used it till I moved here, but the balance leech thing is amazing. I know, not to throw you out here, but when I first came here and asked you about balance leeches, you kind of looked at me and said, well, I think we have 2 of them here.
Right.
And I mean, and now you go downstairs, I guarantee there's bins of them, but it is a super effective bug here. Like when the ice comes off, if you've got 2 balance leeches on and fishing under an indicator with a little bit of a chop, crazy.
Yeah.
Like crazy, because those fish are just on the feed. So that's another super good technique.
So for our viewers that haven't seen one, can you kind of explain, like, they're obviously a little different where the eye orientates, and then like how that affects the fly. And you'd kind of roughly mention chop water and what that would do to the bug.
Yeah, so it's tied on a jig hook, and then when I tie them, I use a pin that you buy at like Hobby Lobby. I cut the pin in half, and then I put a bead on the pin and run it out in front of the jig hook has got either 90 or 60 degree hook eye, and then I'll run that bead out in front of the hook. So then if you take a piece of string or a line and run it through there, that will sit horizontal versus just hanging underneath your indicator. Again, when you got waves, it's basically swimming. And, you know, they've they're jig hooking minnows. They're jig or they're balancing minnows. They're balancing damsels. The balanced leech thing is the big one, but they're balancing other bugs as well to make it just that profile look better. And then I'm actually looking at maybe getting rid of the post out front and just using a jig hook with a weight on it. And I normally fish with a floating line and then under an indicator. That's kind of my go-to, but I also use a full sink. I use a medium sink, and then I bought it from you guys, but a midge tip, which sinks about an inch a second, which is really good for like damsel flies. So if you ever on the river or you're on the lake and you see these blue dragonflies, you see the blue dragonflies, well, that's actually a damsel fly. Well, those bugs, if you're ever out in the lake, those bugs swim like this. I mean, it's crazy. They wiggle like you wouldn't believe, but you get them out there and you throw them under a slow sink and strip them, inch them back. Those fish will tattoo them. Done it out at Golden Eye several times, and it's fun. Like they blow it up. Like they don't miss. That's not a meal they want to miss because it's a slow moving meal, but it's definitely moving. And then I've also out there done pretty well on what the heck is the word I'm looking for? Not a sow bug.
Water boatman.
Water boatman, yes. Yeah? Yes, water boatman. And I never fished, you know, you go to, there's a shop in Colorado, and that's the guy tells you every time you walk in there, he goes, oh, they're eating water boatman. So I must have had 30 of them in my box, because every time I go in, I'm like, I got to have water boatman.
He had bought a bunch one year.
He got a deal on water boatman, and he's like, I'm selling the water boatman. And so I've been out and fishing again that midge tip, which is a slow sink and throwing water boatmen. And in the fall, those things spawn and the water boatmen actually fly when they spawn. Mm-hmm. They'll come out of the water and they'll fly a little bit, but those fish are definitely targeting them. So another pattern that probably never heard of, but effective at times. So, but I would say if you're going to a lake, put on a balanced leech and put on a hare's ear and that's a good starting spot.
Yeah.
Hare's ear by far is my favorite bug on a lake.
Cool.
Green and a natural.
And beadhead, non-beadhead?
Yeah, normally beadhead, but I don't know what it is. I mean, there's just, it just has, you know, looks like a damsel, looks like a calabatus, looks like, you know, dragonfly nymph, looks like a damsel. You know, there's a lot of things that it imitates. And so it's probably one of my better bugs.
Yeah. When you go to a lake, do you approach it from an entomology standpoint, much like a river where you're, might roll a rock or two, or do you just kind of have a rough idea as to?
Normally, I try to see what's on the water. Like lakes will show you what's on the water. Like damselflies. When damselflies are going, it is a ball of 100 damselflies rolling around the top. Sometimes you'll see a fish come up and just smoke that ball, or sometimes you don't see it, but you know. And same thing. I don't really ever. I never turn over rocks, but I normally look to see what's going on the surface. And, you know, like I said, sometimes the wind's blowing and the hoppers are blowing in the water, and those fish, they take their opportunities whenever they can. So,
yeah.
I mean, I'd start there, start a hare's ear and a leech, and I think you'd probably be all right.
Gear wise, what's your kind of go to? Obviously, you're fishing it from shore. Sounds like some from a drift boat. I don't know if you spend much time in a float tube, but.
Well, I used to spend time in the float tube, but then I always realized that the waves would hit me in the back and go over my back and keep me wet all the time. Plus, it's hard to pee out of a float tube, so that's always another problem. You know, I'm a 5-weight guy, so I just fish the five weight. I have like a Helios and the 5-weight floating line, and then like I said, I got the sinking and the midge tip, but nothing fancy.
Yeah.
I mean, at Goldeneye, it's not uncommon to see your back in 2-3 times a day. I mean, you hook one of them fish and they're not expecting it. The first thing they do is blow up and go. And that, again, that's part of the cool thing about fishing lakes is like, it's just when they are hooked, it's just a different deal. So it's fun.
Yeah. I think a lot of people kind of underestimate the growth rate of a lake fish versus river fish just because of the easy living, often an abundant food source, steady water temps. They can really pack the pounds on pretty fast.
Yeah, there's a lake kind of out by Independence Rock, which I'll not name, but you come out of there with your waders on, you'll have hundreds, if not thousands, of scuds on your legs. It's just crazy how much food is in these lakes.
Yeah.
Just food factories. And then these fish, when you catch them, you know, they got the little bitty heads and then just the huge, crazy bodies. And it's just because they just eat. That's all they do. So
in a lake like that where you have a total abundance of food, is your strategy to try to match that sort of hatch, or is it to stand out with a different color scheme? Or
boy, I don't know. I always do it on the river too. It's just like, how can this fish choose my bug over the thousand that are coming off? Why do they choose that bug? But more times than not, they do choose it. Same thing in a lake. It's like, I'm like, I got 500 scuds in here. If I throw a scud that looks like it, did they eat it? Like, when they come through, I think, you know, they come through in a wave, those fish are eating anything that looks like food, and they just don't care. And
right.
Like I said, they'll just clean it out. So, it's one of the only things that baffles me, even with, like I said, on the river, is you'll throw out a hopper next to a hopper, and it's like, what are the chances it's going to eat my fake hopper versus the real one right next to it? About 50%, you know?
Yeah.
So.
Awesome. Well, thanks for joining us.
Of course.
Appreciate it. Yep. Place people can find you.
Find me on Instagram. I'm not big on the Instagram, but YFlyCasters is what my name is.
Awesome. Appreciate it, Fish. Yep, thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Ugly Bug Podcast. If you've enjoyed this episode, please consider subscribing and leaving a review on Apple Podcasts and Spotify. If you have questions or feedback, reach out to us via email at info@uglybugpodcast.com or leave a comment on our social networks.